from the lesions, characteristic lesions that we see in that patient, that is Sankar, from syphilitic patient whose name was syphilis. Okay. Since this organism was first identified from the patient name as syphilis, the name of this disease was given as a syphilis. Okay. And the causative agent is treponema pallidum. Then syphilis is the classical venereal disease transmitted by atypical bacteria, Treponema pallidum or spirochetes, and acquired syphilis is transmitted exclusively by sexually contact. That's classically the venereal disease or sexually transmitted disease. However, vertical transmission from infected mother to growing inside the mother's womb is also possible. That may lead to the congenital syphilis. Okay, based on the mode of transmission, the syphilis can be acquired one and the congenital one. Okay, so now let us discuss regarding the characteristic features of the causative agent of the syphilis. As I have already mentioned, this is little bit atypical than that of the other common bacteria that we discuss. These Treponema pallidums are spiral-shaped bacteria. Trepos means thorns and nema means thread. That means they have the regular turning, very fine thread-like structures, and they are very difficult to stain by the routine stains. That's why they retain very pale in staining. That's why the name Treponema pallidum has been given. Okay, they are the very thin, slender, spiral-shaped bacilli, and see the size. Usually, the common bacteria that we discuss sizes around 1 to 3 micrometer in their length, but these are relatively larger, okay, 10 micrometer longer, 10 micrometer, but very thin. They are thin and hard to see by a light microscope because they are very thin, okay, and they can be demonstrated by dark field microscopy, and they are actively motile with the axial filament that they possess. They do not have the true flagella, but they have the flagella that are present on the body surface as a, called as axial filament. With the help of that axial filaments, they are actively motile, and that motility can be better visualized by dark field microscopy. They cannot be seen under the light microscope since they are very thin and they do not readily or easily retain the stain. They can be demonstrated by silver impregnation methods because impregnation with a silver stain increases their thickness so that they can be easy. However, Masson-Fontana stains, Leberti stains, Zimta stains can also be used to demonstrate them. But rather than the easily demonstrated directly into the dark field microscope in wet films or wet smear. This is not the real picture. This one is the real image of the spirochetes that are observed in the dark field microscopy. They are spiral and shaped, okay, and they are actively motile. It is very difficult to cultivate pathogenic treponemes. That's why they cannot be grown in artificial culture media. However, they can be remain viable, or they can be propagated in animal inoculations. And here we'll do the serial testicular passage in the rabbit. Okay, the pathogenic strains of treponemes, that is the Nichols strain, can be maintained viable by the serial testicular passage in rabbit. Okay, non-pathogenic strains, that is the Reiter strains, can be cultivated. In India, though they are non-pathogenic, but they have the antigenic similarities with the pathogenic Treponema pallidums, and they can be cultivable. and they are important for diagnosis. Okay, since they have the antigenic similarities, those antigens can be used for the diagnostic purpose. Those non-pathogenic strains can be cultivated in routine media like a thioglycolate media. Okay, now pathogenesis is very important. It is most commonly asked question in repro. Okay, pathogenesis of syphilis and the laboratory diagnosis. And the laboratory diagnosis part we'll do in practical session also, and we'll discuss more in practicals. I think we'll start practicals nearby within the month. I think you also have notice regarding this. Here the pathogenesis is important, as I have already mentioned. While discussing the pathogenesis, the most important is the course of the disease, how the disease develops, okay, in the patient. That is important. Now the patient may acquire infections by sexual contact or from the mother to the fetus. Incubation period may vary. First, what happens during the sexual contact? The organisms or that is treponemes may enter inside through the abraded skins in the genital area. They multiply there locally, and the patient will have some characteristic lesions that is called as chancre at the local site, and they multiply little bit there. And they incurs into the lymphatics and disseminated via the blood systems, blood streams, and disseminated all over the body. And they may lodge in any organ. This is the basic concept. Okay, first they multiply locally at the inoculated site. Okay, and then they incurs into the lymphatics and then to circulation, and may this got circulated all over the body. Okay, so during that times, mainly four features of the syphilis can be described. Okay, number one is the primary syphilis, secondary syphilis, latent syphilis, tertiary, and the quaternary syphilis. Primary syphilis means during the sexual contact, when that treponemes got the abraded skins, and via the abraded skins and the mucosal linings, they penetrate and they multiply locally. And they will show the characteristic lesions, okay, at the genital area, that is called as chancre, okay. And after after some weeks, okay, after 4 to 6 weeks, that characteristic lesions will automatically subside, and then the disease progresses into the secondary syphilis. During that times, the organisms into the organisms enters into the blood circulations. Okay, multiply there, but the patient will not have any kind of typical clinical features. Okay, some non-specific clinical features the patient may have. Okay, malaise, weakness, low-grade fever, some papular like rashes in the skin, such kind of non-specific features that the patient may have. Okay. And during this phase, the bacteria are actively multiplying in that site, okay? But the patient is not symptomatic. They do not have any typical characteristic features. And after some time, the these features also got subsided, and the organisms remains there in the latent stage, and the patient will not have any kind of clinical features at all. That is called as latent stage, and it may remain for several years, 5 to 10 years, okay? And after the end of those latent stages, in some individuals, they may again reactivate it, and they may affect the vital organs, and that is called complicated syphilis or the tertiary or the quaternary syphilis, okay? These are the main features in the syphilis, okay, that we'll discuss. Right. So now here, what happens in the primary syphilis? The bacteria multiply at the local site, and they form the characteristic lesions that is called as chancre. That is that they have the painless, relatively avascular, circumscribed, indurated, superficially ulcerated lesions at the genital area. That chancre or that primary lesions in primary syphilis can be seen in external genitalia, but sometimes on the cervix, perianal area, or the individuals who are having unusual orovaginal, oroanal, or anopenile sexual activity, unusual sexual activity in the individuals, the lesions can be in mouth as well as the anal canal. Okay, but it is very rare. That's why the lesions can be at any part. Okay, external genitalia, sometimes in the cervix, perianal area, or in the individuals who is having unusual sexual activity. In those individuals, the lesions can be in mouth or in the anal canal. See, these are the, this is the characteristic lesions that is seen in the penile shaft. Okay, and these lesions are highly indurated, and this is painless. Okay, non-itchy. The patient usually do not notice it. Okay, because this kind of lesions are painless and non-itchy, the patient usually not notice it. Okay, and then after a few weeks, these lesions automatically got healed. And see here, the regional lymph nodes also got enlarged here. So that happens in the syphilis, in the primary syphilis. Okay, so now in what happens in the secondary syphilis? So now after a few weeks, the primary lesions that we see, that the chancre lesions automatically got healed. The patient will not have any kind of features. The organisms spread widely via the blood streams. There is the widespread multiplication of the organisms, as I have already mentioned. The patient may have the papular skin rashes, and in those lesions, in those skin rashes, the organisms are very abundant. And this is the most infectious stage. Okay, and the patient sometimes have the ophthalmic, osseous, and meningeal involvement, but the patient are asymptomatic. Okay, see, this kind of papular rashes can be seen all over the skin, but after some time, these rashes got automatically healed. Okay, so that's why the patient usually do not notice it, because these are non-itchy, non-painful. Only the patient will have the papular rashes all over the skin, low-grade fever, malaise, weakness, such kind of non-specific features. The most important point in this is, in this phase, the bacteria multiply rapidly, and there will be the widespread multiplication as well as the dissemination of the organisms all over the body via the blood circulation. But the patient will not have any kind of typical clinical features in this case. Okay, that's why this disease is called as hidden disease. Okay, because during the whole course of the disease, the patient will not have any kind of typical features. That's why the disease remains undiagnosed, and in some individuals or in some proportion, in some peoples, these infections may complicate it to the quaternary or the complicated syphilis. If the patient have the complicated syphilis, then it is very difficult to say. Okay, it is almost fatal condition. For example, if the patient is having syphilis, and if he or she develops neurosyphilis, okay, then it is almost a fatal conditions, right? So why it is important? Because during the whole course of the disease, the patient remains asymptomatic, and those patient who not got diagnosed will not treat it. And he or she could be the source of infection to other individuals. Okay. And then when complicated, it is already late to save the patient. That is very important point in this case. Okay. So here some non-specific features the patient might have. And these remains for almost 1 month. Okay. And the disease enters into the latent stage. Means, during this latent phase, the patient will not have any kind of clinical features, and it may remain for several years. Okay, and in these cases, the diagnosis can be made by the serological test. So now, in almost 80 to 90%, or in most of the cases, these latent stages followed natural cure. Okay, after several years, the disease got automatically cured. But the important one in some individuals, okay, in some cases, the patient or the organisms again reactivated, and the disease may enter into the complicated features. Okay, the patient may develop neurological manifestations, and that is typically called as neurosyphilis. Okay, and vital organ got affected, and the patient will die. Okay, that is the complicated or the quaternary syphilis. Right. So these are the different typical four stages of the syphilis that we have to discuss in pathogenesis. Okay. The mode of infection, as you all know, in primary syphilis, what happens? The organism multiply locally, and there will be the primary lesions at the site of infection, basically the genital lesions. That is typically called as chancre, which is painless, non-itchy lesions seen in the genital area. And that chancre got automatically healed, and the patient enters into the secondary stage, that is called as secondary syphilis. In secondary syphilis, there will be the widespread multiplication and spread of the organisms all over the body via the lymphatic channels and the blood streams. Okay, the patient might have the some non-specific features like as a malaise, weakness, low grade fever, arthralgia, myalgia, appearance in some individuals, appearance of the papular lesions all over the skins, that in the secondary stage, and that may remain for month, and after month the disease enters into the latent stage. During that time, the patient will not have any kind of clinical features at all. The patient remains normal, okay, asymptomatic. But during that time, the patient can be diagnosed by serological diagnosis. Okay, that is the latent stage. In most of the individuals, that latent stage proceed as a natural cure. Okay, the patient got automatically healed. But in some cases, the complication can also occur, that is called quaternary syphilis or the complicated syphilis. Okay, this is regarding the pathogenesis and the clinical features of the syphilis. So now let us discuss regarding the diagnosis, how we can diagnose. The level of diagnosis depends upon the stage of the disease, okay, in which stage the patient is there. So now, the sample, what could be the sample? In the primary and secondary syphilis, if we could catch the patient in that stage, as I have already mentioned, the patient will not have any kind of typical clinical features. That's why the disease remains unnoticed. It is very hard to catch the patient during this primary and secondary syphilitic stage. If so, if we could catch the patient in that stage, then if we could collect the sample material from the lesions, characteristic lesions that we see in primary and secondary syphilis, the chances of detection is very high in dark field microscopy, where we directly demonstrate the organisms, that is the treponemes, in dark field microscopy from the sample collected from the lesions. Okay, that is the serous exudate. Here the chances of detection is very high, because lesions, the organisms, that is the bacterial number is very high. Okay, that's why if we could collect that exudate or the samples from the lesions, then we can easily demonstrate them in dark field microscopy. But the question here is that it is very difficult to catch the patient in primary and secondary syphilitic stage, because the patient remains unnoticed, asymptomatic, okay, like this. So now, in latent stage or even in the secondary stage, serological test can be done to diagnose the syphilis, which is the main measures or the mode for the diagnosis of syphilis in the syphilitic patient. Okay, and in neurosyphilis cases, we can use the CSF sample. Okay, now microscopy, as I have already mentioned, in primary and secondary stage, we will collect the sample from the lesion, that is called a serous exudate, and that serous exudate we can use the by using the serous exudate, we can make the wet films, and we can do the dark ground microscopy. Though it has a low sensitivity, but the chances of detection is very high if we collect the samples properly. Okay. They can be detected by fluorescent antibody, that is the direct fluorescent antibody methods. Okay, here what we do, we will stain those exudate by the treponemal pallidum fluorescent antibody, and then we'll observe under the fluorescent microscopy. Okay, and this one is more sensitive than the dark field microscopy, but it requires stain. Okay, fluorescent stain it requires. But in this case, directly you will collect the sample. If you have dark field microscopy, you just prepare the wet smear, okay, and then observe under the dark field microscope, and then you will see like this. You will see like this. Okay, this is the direct microscopy in primary and secondary stage. The most important one is the serological test. Here, what we'll do, we'll try to detect the treponema-specific antibody from the patient's serum. Okay, from the patient's serum. They are called as serological tests. So basically, two types of tests we have. One is the non-treponemal test or non-specific test. That is the VDRL and RPR test. We'll discuss more on practical sessions. And another is the specific test, that is the treponemal pallidum immobilization test, treponemal pallidum hemagglutination test, FTABS, and rapid immunochromatographic tests are also available to detect the treponemal antibody. And these are non-specific because we will not use the treponemal antigen here. We will use the cardiolipin antigens, which are extracted from the ox heart, that reacts, okay, with the serum of the patients. Since we are not using the treponemal antigen here, they are called as non-specific tests. The most important one is the VDRL and the RPR test, where we will mix the patient's serum with the cardiolipin antigen, and we look for the result. These are based on the precipitation reaction that we have discussed in first year, okay, and we will discuss in practical session also. And these are the specific tests because we are using the treponemal antigen here, okay. So since we are detecting the antibody against the treponemal antigens from the patient's serum, they are specific. That is the TPI, treponema pallidum immobilization test, treponema pallidum hemagglutination test, and FTABS. Among them, this TPSA is more commonly employed in most of the laboratory for the diagnosis of syphilis because they are the specific test for the syphilis. Okay, the VDRL test we will discuss more in the practical sessions since we are having practical also. These VDRL tests are based on the principle of precipitation reaction, that is the flocculation test that we have already studied in first year. And what we do, we'll mix the patient sample with the cardiolipin antigen and then we'll rotate in the VDRL shaker for 4 minutes, and if the syphilitic serum is there, then there will be the formation of the visible clumps, and you can easily read the result. RPR is the principal reaction, but this is modification of the VDRL test. Okay, in VDRL test, we require microscope to visualize the reaction. That's why to overcome there, in RPR, along with the cardiolipin antigens, some carbon particles also being added to make the result that can be observed by the naked eye, and it does not require to inactivate the serum. Okay, that we'll discuss in practical sessions. These RPR and VDRL are the non-specific tests. Okay, point to be noted, that is, they are the non-specific test because we are not using the treponemal antigen here. Okay, but they are most commonly done test for the diagnosis of syphilis because they are very cheap and easy to perform. Okay, though they are non-specific, that's why they are very useful to screen the syphilitic patient. However, since they are the non-specific test, we are using cardiolipin antigens in VDRL and RPR tests. Some false positive result can also be present. Okay, that is called as biological false positive result. Here we get the positive result. Okay, we get the positive result by using this cardiolipin test, but the patient is actually having. Not having syphilis. Okay, how we define is the positive reaction obtained in cardiolipin test with a negative result in specific treponemal test in the absence of past or present treponemal infection and not caused by any technical fault. Okay, means very simple. The patient is not having syphilis, but you will get the positive test. That is called as biological false positive. Okay. It can be seen in certain diseases like as systemic lupus erythematosus, leprosy, malaria, relapsing fever. Okay, the infectious mononucleosis, hepatitis. In this condition, the patient might have a false positive result. Even in the pregnancy, sometimes you will get a false positive result. Okay, in a specific test, we have the TPI, FPABS, and TPSA. We'll discuss more in. Practical sessions. Okay. Now, every diagnosis and pathogenesis of syphilis is important from examination point of view because it is more commonly asked in final examination or in Kathmandu University examination. So that's why we prepare in pathogenesis and every diagnosis. Okay. So now, this is the sensitivity of this test during this stage. Okay. VRL, FPABS, TPPA, and among them, the most sensitive. One is the FTABS, okay, fluorescent treponemal antibody absorbance test. So this is more about the disease. If you have any questions, then we can discuss. Otherwise, I will do attendance. How to do the attendance? To go to the participation and download attendance list. Do you have any question?
No, Tej.